And we're back. Dynamic effort lower body day. I do my speed work a little bit different than most, but we'll wait to the gym to get to that because today is a very exciting package delivery day. Now, since I've been back in Canada, I have been sharing my Olympic lifter shoes with my dad on my lower body training. And now that Cole is back, I've been sharing them with Cole and my dad. And instead of continuing to go on with the communal Albersworth family shoe, I'm just lucky that Mianna has like size 3 feet or else she'd be wearing them too. I ordered a freshie pair. And the pair that I ordered is a little bit to do with the features of the shoe and a lot to do with the speed of shipping because Cole needed them for today, I needed them for today, and if I was going to order something new, I wanted to be able to overnight it and get it here for today. And Inner Strength Products out in Regina, I guess they're in Moose Jaw, it shipped from Regina. Inner Strength Products from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. Regina is also a real place. You should Google it, it's kind of funny sounding. But got this wonderful box from them. Also, check out my box opening knife that Mianna hates, but I refuse to get anything else for, you know, the very large knife you need to open up Amazon packages on a daily basis. It's actually really dull. My hand is kind of better as I try to not slice my finger open getting this thing up and running. This is actually like, trying to do this on camera is way more dangerous than like if I can like focus on just like slicing and not cutting, you know, or stabbing a dog. Like it's easy to do when I'm not on camera, but when I'm on camera, much more difficult. Okay. Holy guacamole, tight fit in the box. Wow. Can you tell that this is my first time? This is like, yeah. Anyways. Sleek black packaging. T-Y-R, tier, I don't know. These are the wide toe box Olympic lifters. And like I said, like the reason I went with this, like I have been running Reeboks. And the big reason I went with this was the shipping more so than the wide toe box. But the wide toe box is going to be a very, very, very neato thing for me because I'm not really into the whole like barefoot splay idea as being totally advantageous, going to fix your problems with a squat, but these things are actually really nice. But I bought into the barefoot shoe thing years and years and years ago when I was just a gullible little child, thinking that switching to barefoot shoes, thinking that letting my foot splay would solve all of my ankle, my knee, my hip problems, and it didn't. I had to put in a lot of work to get my ankles and hips and knees to work better outside of just changing my footwear. And what barefoot shoes left me with was that I had a really wide foot that hurt anytime I wore normal footwear, which isn't ideal just because now I'm stuck needing to wear clown shoes and like the Reeboks I was wearing were a lot bigger than they needed to be just so that my foot could fit in. So I'm hoping that this wider toe box, which doesn't look insane, but it is a little bit wider, should allow me to get into a shoe that can actually fit my foot and not look like a clown. So we're gonna see about that. And like in terms of, I don't even know what I'm supposed to talk about with a product unboxing, but they look neat. The rubber's sticky, heel feels solid, Velcro feels nice. They got straps because I'm lazy and I don't want to, you know, tie my shoes up right. That should be nice for me in that regard. But I'm gonna take my sweet ass time trying to get these laces undone. So many laces. I'm actually like nervous with how like small the hole is and like how hard it is to like coax the thing open with how fat my feet are. You guys ready? I'm gonna tilt the camera down. Hopefully it doesn't trip. Tighten, come on. Oh no. Where's that pointing? Okay, that's pointing in the right spot. Whew. First initial slip in. Wiggle, wobble. Sticking lefty in. Yep. definitely a very small hole to be putting my foot in. Yeah, I don't know. They are a little bit snugger than I would love, but the toe box does have a decent amount of space for the size, and I think I probably would have been happier with a 11.5 than an 11. But stand up, do some squatties. Okay, yeah. Very riveting stuff. It's like I can feel like I'm stretching a little bit, so I'm not super worried about the width just yet. I think like it's not like panic, return them, get a bigger size, but definitely a little snugger. And what do you know? They are a heel elevated squat shoe. Nothing all that magical. And I guess like the point that I wanna make with this whole getting new shoes thing and like why I chose the ones that I chose being mostly shipping timeline than anything else is that a shoe isn't going to be the biggest difference maker to your total. Like yes, having a shoe that fits will help if you have a shoe that does not fit. Yes, having an elevated heel will help if you're someone who needs more ankle range access to get into their quads. But beyond that, like all of this hype around this shoe is going to revolutionize this, that, or the other, it's just marketing hype. And I know I kind of did fall for it myself right now in this video just because I wanted to get the wider one because my feet are wider and it turns out they're not all that wide. So I'm a little bit like, I maybe should have waited the shipping for the Reeboks. But you know what? I got them. They're on my feet. They feel like they are going to break in a little bit. So I'm going to train in them, see how they go. So let's eat that meal and cut to the gym for the speed squats. Update. Kept them on while making the old oatmeal and berries and I am feeling more optimistic about them breaking in and being, you know, snug, not unwearable. So, now, cutting to the gym. About to get rolling on the work sets of the speed squats, and now that I got some more time in the shoes, they kind of opened up and broken in. My initial skepticalness of whether or not they would actually fit me, they work, they feel comfy, they're good. I don't think they're gonna be like a world changer for anyone, like this play isn't gonna change your life, but me and my fat feet, I'm comfy, I'm happy, they're gonna work, running high bar squats for speed work this wave. And basically my goal with the high bars is just to reintroduce squatting with a straight bar on my back. I started out with cambered bar as kind of the ease in, moved to buffalo bar last wave, now onto a high bar, and then if this wave continues to pan out well as it is, gonna go to a low bar comp squat next wave, and that'll be back to low bar comp squatting. So we'll get into it. Set one, gotta say that less squeaky. Set one. This is a mouth guard. Whoops. Trying to figure out why the fuck I'm so overarched. Last one. Yes, sir. Yeah. I spent a long time training speed deadlifts really hard and then wondering, why does my deadlift still suck? And then I spent a long time thinking that speed deadlifts didn't work for me. And it took me a little while to realize why it didn't work, and it's because when a deadlift is in that speed work lightness range, I can just default to lumbar extension and overarch and make it feel really fast and make it feel really, really snappy, but it's totally ignoring my weak points and it's not heavy enough to punish me for going towards a pattern that I can't maintain with heavy weights. So training conventional speed pulls is kind of a very fine line to ride for me. If I'm super deliberate, I can make it work okay, but what I found works a billion times better, very, very precise number there, is training speed pulls sumo. Because with sumo, I can't default to that lumbar extension. I'm forced to keep it in the hips, and the hip extension is what I need more of on conventional, so I get double bang for the buck. I get to practice having a hip-driven deadlift, and I get to build up a little bit more hip at the same time. Stuff. So deal with these is that if I'm doing them on my left leg, I want my right side facing the lever and I'll be holding onto it with my right hand. That way it's going to be helping push me into the lateral hip, it's going to help me find more hip internal rotation, and then I got to push my way out of it and it becomes really, really, really gnarly on both glute med and glute max and just gets a freaking phenomenal butt cheek pump for you. And this week, trying to get a little bit more range of motion since that was slacking last week with the hammy tweak. We're just trying to get into some hammy length, even if this isn't really a pure hamstring exercise. Still good to get a little bit of stretchy stretch in there for it. Gonna run one more and then figure out what the hell I'm doing next. And laziness prevails once again, which is pretty common on accessories for me. And what I mean by that is, like, I'm not saying that I like want to be lazy with my accessories, but if I have something that I need to train, but I don't have a specific thing that I'm trying to accomplish with it, there's not something specific that I need to be doing, I'll often just pick a movement that I like and that is convenient. And because I already had plates on here for the RDLs, might as well just bang out some rows. So we're gonna bang out some rows. Yeah, chest support T-bars are sick. Gonna run another. (Laughs) And what makes these machines sick is that these handles, they don't move that way. So you can straighten and pull down against these handles while you're rowing and get even gnarlier squeeze, gnarlier contraction. This really big old dirty lat pump, which always feels friggin' awesome. And I think I'm just gonna compound on that feeling with some pull downs. And nerds are gonna say that that's upper back, not lat. And yes, doing pull downs, doing water pull downs is going to be biased more relatively to teres major. And if you think about teres major versus lat, they are two muscles that have very similar lines of pull, but there's a very big difference. Teres major runs from shoulder blade to humerus, whereas lat runs from rib cage to humerus and crosses the shoulder blade. So if we want to get more lats into any pull down, if we lead with scap depression, that is going to be lat leading the contraction, so we can get more lat in. And a lot of times, if someone has really, really, really shitty lats, they're just jerking off their pull downs, not getting any depression. They're making it all teres, zero lat, maybe a little bit of pec help if they're really rounding over. So start with depression, keep chest tall, you're going to get lats into pull down. Been avoiding these, and knowing how those squat sets went, they're probably gonna be pretty beneficial if I run them with the right intent. Yeah, I'm bad at those right now. So what I'm trying to do is really limit lumbar extension at the bottom and really squeeze my glutes hard and almost push through the foot plate like I'm trying to lock out a conventional deadlift. I know it doesn't quite look like that, but man, does it feel gnarly, like right above the pubic bone in the lower abs. And that's like that pull through there is what I was really struggling with finding on those squats when I was overarching. So gonna run some more of these here to try to get better at that, and hopefully we can carry it back over to our squats on Sunday. Forgot to do leg curls, so I just jammed out on some leg curls. Have to take my word for it, because it's the standing hammer strength curl thingy in the corner, and there's no angle to film it from. It isn't like pointing directly up my butthole, and like, somebody might want to see that, but I'm assuming most of y'all don't, and I really don't want to show it. So yeah, I'll film hamstrings when I'm doing something that isn't that machine. But that machine feels really good. Get a really nice stretchy, really nice squeezy on her, and it's just good to pump them up at the end of a session, especially like with coming back from that little bit of strain. It feels really, really, really good at getting that kind of strained area to be less sensitive and feel like it is contracting better. And kind of speaking of the strain, but more in regards to like jacking up those squats, like I'm not stoked that I jacked up those squats. Like, I'm not thrilled, and like old Seth would have gotten really, really, really pissed off that he screwed up those squats. And getting pissed off about not executing in the gym is, it's easy to do because we're here, we're putting so much effort in, and we always want to do as well as we can. But sometimes our expectations of how well we can do aren't matching what we're actually doing in the moment. And that was one of those times today, because like I felt like I was dialed, I felt like I was locked in. That's like, I checked the video 3 sets in, it's like, holy shit, that's a dumpster fire. And yeah, it was frustrating to like think that I was locked, but just being pissed off at it and like throwing a hissy fit isn't gonna fix the problem. What's gonna fix the problem is fixing the problem. And the more frustrated, the more pissed off you get, the less likely you're gonna be to think clearly enough to actually address it and take that step back to realize, like, why is this problem happening? Why am I doing this thing? Why is my body not moving the way that I want it to? What am I cueing wrong? What am I setting wrong? What am I doing differently than the last session or the last time that it worked well? And if you're able to stay calm and take that step back, you're going to be so much better able to solve problems in the gym rather than just banging your head against the wall and getting pissed off. And it's like, yes, we get it. Like, you're angry because you care, but but if you really do care about it, you will find a way to step back, calm down, look at the situation, and figure things out. And I think that's like the biggest thing a lot of intermediate lifters struggle with, and the reason why a lot of intermediates, it's not the only reason intermediates get stuck, but it's one of them, is that they just struggle with processing adversity. And what is often lost in social media world of training is that everything that gets posted often looks like a highlight reel. Like, you see the strong lifters just doing insane looking shit all the time. And yeah, a lot of it does look insane, but it only looks insane because they built themselves up to this point. And what I'm really hoping by like vlogging this whole meat prep is that you guys are going to be able to see like how not great a prep can start, and how like not in shape I can be, and how not spectacular my lifts can look, and how much I can turn it around. And like, this obviously coming off of surgery isn't the best way to enter a meat prep, but that doesn't mean that it's going to be a shit meat. That doesn't mean that I'm not going to be able to dig in, figure things out, and make progress from where I am here. And I've started meat preps in a lot worse shape than this and still done pretty good. And I'm thinking that if I continue to do better at everything that I'm trying to do better with, both lifting wise and perspective wise, it should at least pan out pretty cool. And I'm hoping that you guys can learn something along the way. So I'm gonna get out of here, gonna go eat some food, finish up a little bit of work, get to bed, and get back at her tomorrow.